unabashed laughter is fucking wonderful.
It's pretty great.
And they left his genuine reaction in the movie. What a wonderful film.
Well, you know...
What's not a wonderful film?
No. Well, yeah, I do. I have plenty of examples. The Revenant. Why am I talking like a five-year-old? The Revenant.
Attack of the Clones. Two movies on equal footing, honestly.
Yes. Oh, my God. Yes. But the Curse of the Werewolf.
Oh, I had a thing I was going to
do. Oh, what were you going to say? Back to one. You do it.
I was going to say, well, one thing that Attack of the Clones has over The Revenant and the movie we're doing today is that it has Christopher Lee in it, unlike the film today.
What? Oh, my God. You're right, actually. That's funny.
Curse of the Werewolf on the Spooktator good. Film podcast. I don't know how we're going to save that in editing, but I'm sure we will.
I'm pretty good editor, Max. Yeah.
Yes. Hello, everyone. Yeah. Welcome to the Spooktator Film Podcast. We're doing the continuation of our very Hammer Halloween with the film The Curse of the Werewolf. Ooh. As I said,
I can't fix that in editing, though. Sorry.
I think that was perfect.
Okay.
I gave you some stuff to work with.
Well, never mind then.
Yeah, but we're doing Curse of the Werewolf, another Hammer film. We decided to keep going down the list of monsters.
Excuse me, what's your name?
Max, right, fuck. Yeah, there we go. Sorry, I forget sometimes.
Max, right, fuck?
Yes, right. Right is my middle name.
Well, that sounds fucking wrong. That's what I got to say to you. I was going to add that to editing. You got to stop doing this. Just let me do it, Max. This is how I make my money. Just let me do it. I'm Austin, by the way.
I have to pay you every time you add a sound effect. I don't have that much money, Austin. I'm sorry.
But yes, you are correct in your statement of the movie we are doing today. It would be very bizarre if you were wrong. It would be very awkward. But yes. So wait, whose choice was this?
It was kind of mutual because we had another movie.
Honestly, all our choices are yeah. for this themed month have been
it's not really a back and forth. It is, but like we have a library and we're just like, oh, let's do this one this week. Let's do this one. We were just going to do a different one, but then we decided to switch gears.
Get a new monster in there.
Yeah. And a lot of the fun of Hammer, at least for me, is to, because they are very directly influenced by the success of the Universal era monster movies.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the more famous Universal ones is the Wolfman. So why not do Hammer's response to that? Although, I think we have slightly differing opinions on this movie to a degree, which we'll elaborate on later. But why don't you talk about your history in this? Because you have a much more, I would say, memorable experience with this movie than I do, which is I had forgotten I had seen this movie. So
so I had memory of it to begin with.
Yes.
Yes, of course. I watched this movie for peak form tonight. Perfect. I watched this movie for the first time a few years ago, and I thought at the time, like, it really stuck out in my memory compared to a lot of other Hammer movies that I was watching because it has such a bizarre structure, which I'm going to guess is part of our disagreements, which I don't even know if they'll end up being disagreements, but just one thing we both latched onto in terms of thinking about this movie was the way its structure has an impact on the story it's actually telling. I thought it was, like, very interesting at the time, and then especially revisiting it, I think I find the structure of this movie kind of fascinating, especially compared to the other Hammer movies, and the way it spans multiple generations. But at the same time, I think it also sort of hampers its ability to be entertaining in a more straightforward way that I think other Hammer movies are very successful at being entertaining in that way. So compared to some other ones, it has some weaknesses that it gains by trying to make this sort of structural decision that maybe is not interesting enough or committed to enough in its own right to revive the movie for everyone. But I still think it's interesting. It's the only werewolf movie they made because it didn't make a ton of money. I
can't imagine why.
Wait, do you really hate this movie?
I don't hate it. I'm just going to be grumpy about
okay,
it.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
You'll be the heel today. I got to take some time off.
But I didn't finish this movie. I saw it when I was like 15. And I just had like, I That was when my local video store had just gone out of business and I had gotten a bunch of the Hammer stuff on DVD. And I watched, I think, about a third of this movie before I realized, yeah, Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee weren't in it, just because it was part of a box set and I was just sort of going through DVD to DVD. And I'm just like, well, this is weird. And the reason I'm watching a lot of these Hammer films when I'm a 15-year-old is not in them. So next movie, please. And then you're like, what about Curse of the Werewolf for this week? And I'm just like, sure. I don't really have any solid memory of it and I never finished it. So it will be great to go back and yet again laugh at my teenage self for having no taste in movies and chuckle at how far I've come and how I can appreciate great art now. And then I watched the movie. So last week we did The Gorgon. And yes. The Gorgon is a flawed movie. And I would say the biggest flaw of the movie is pacing, which I talked about a lot last time. And the pacing issues in The Gorgon come a lot from the fact that, okay, you have this brother, and the brother has a lover, and the lover dies, and then the brother dies, and then the father comes to investigate the brother's death, but then the father dies in the investigation of that, and then the other brother has to come and investigate both of their deaths, and then Christopher Lee has to come to help them, and then he dies.
It's like an infinite like regression of like investigations that go nowhere until eventually you just reach like eventually Christopher Lee, who can finally do literally anything about it.
And I think this movie has a similar thing with the generational structure that it takes.
It's like it does start over with Oliver Reed in the second half.
And I'm just like, wait, what? Oof, where am I? This is, it's technically the same like themes and stuff carrying through, but it like feels almost like they realized this movie wasn't going to do that well, and they crammed the sequel that they already had planned for this movie into the first movie.
And that's an interesting way to put it.
Because, like, Hammer, they made a bajillion fucking movies. They had so many sequels. And based on how successful the Universal Wolfman was, they had no reason to not suspect that this wouldn't do as well as some of their other properties.
It's interesting you mentioned that because they did have a sequel planned, actually.
Yeah.
Because they were being really successful at this time. They had, like, invested some money in it, too. Like, they had a title, a script, and everything. Like, I believe it was called Curse of the Werewolf 2. Your sister is a werewolf.
I saw, as soon as you said, I believe it was called, I was like, oh, fucking, where is going with this?
Wait a second.
Christopher Lee was in that movie.
Or no, is he in the third one?
No, he's in Your Sister is a Werewolf.
He's in a rock band or something.
No, he's not.
No.
Oh my God. He goes to a rock club wearing sunglasses in that movie, and it's fucking amazing.
Yes. Yes.
So, honestly, go watch Halloween 2, Your Sister is a Werewolf instead.
Christopher Lee's
in that movie.
For anyone who hasn't listened to this, this tangent is worth it, because this title is maybe the most bizarre title in film history. Maybe even beating out Atlantic Rim. Because the thing about this title is that it's not like the Howling 2 : Your Sister is a Werewolf. It's an ellipses. So it's like, it's so bizarre because it's like you have the title and it's like, okay, now the title, the ellipses implies like a speaker. It like implies that you're thinking about what you're saying, right? So it's like the title is like Howling 2. Let me pause while I think about what I'm about to say. Your sister is a werewolf. Very bizarre.
Oh my God.
So anyway.
And also the original title of it was Howling 2 or Howling She-Bitch, was it?
Oh, no. Turbo She-Bitch. I think that was the Australian title.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Australians always get the better titles. they had Brain Dead instead of Dead Alive. But that was just because they didn't want to have it competing with another movie that came out around the same time.
I just mashed them together. Brain Alive Dead.
Exactly. You know, the Peter Jackson one.
But anyway, so how the fuck did we start talking about this? The Gorgon?
Because we're not talking. We don't want to talk about this movie.
I'm excited to talk about this movie. I do agree with you that it would have been more fun if they had managed to get one of their, you know, Peter Cushing or Christopher Lee in there.
That's another thing. When we were talking about, when we were shooting ideas of our impressions of the movie, I said that one of my bigger problems is not just like as a fanboy of Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee, but like of acting.
Yeah.
Is a lot of the Hammer films are cheesy. A lot of elements of them haven't aged well because they were made in a very conservative England, and it's just sort of like, this isn't great.
Maybe ideologically. Yeah.
But there's still reason to go back to them because you have amazing anchor performances in all of them. You have Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing driving the narrative. And even if the world around them sometimes crumbles a little bit, you have them to hold you into this world and make it believable and enjoyable to go through.
You just want to watch these guys stab vampires and other monsters of the dark.
Exactly. Yeah. This has okay acting. I'm not going to bash too much on our two leads, but like, it's not that level. And it is like, it allows your mind to wander to just like, sure. Oh, this is cheap.
Well, that's the implications behind this. I think to relate it back to what you're saying about pacing too with this movie. And then the way you compare it to the Gorgon is like, there is no Christopher Lee to save you in this movie. And it's part of it too, is that structure. It's like, what we're probably going to talk about it a lot during the commentary track, but just the fact of them doing the structure is interesting in its own right. Right. But then the way they do it, the way they execute on that, it kind of like creates this vacuum where it's like, even if you did cast Peter Cushing or Christopher Lee, it's like, I don't really know if any of these roles like give them space to fill with
their
charisma.
No, I'm not saying they should have. I wish they had found a third, like, they had found somebody to play their Wolfman or something that like matched the presence of those two, like a third
pillar. I think Oliver Reed has presence.
Reed is a good actor. He's a career actor. He's been in so many fucking things. I actually looked him up after this. I'm like,
he's
Jesus
one of those,
Christ.
One of those people who would definitely do an entire movie just so he could go drinking.
Yeah. And wouldn't we all?
Most fun to work with, those people. Well, I'll divulge some trivia about Oliver Reed during the commentary.
Oh God.
But yeah, so I think he gives a good performance here, and I agree that he's a, you know, he definitely has a interesting and like engaging presence as an actor. But again, I do think it's part of that structural thing. It's like, I don't know if this movie has space for any of those fun performances that you usually associate with these Hammer movies. So I totally understand what you're saying.
And I don't want to come off as too negative. The movie's fine.
Right.
It has, at least a lot for the first half, it has wonderfully fun set design for a lot of it. A lot of great period costumes, I think, even if it is cheesy, but it kind of adds to the general tone the movie is going for, and I like it.
Mm-hmm.
I do like the first part of it a bit. I think it's after the generational gap thing that it's sort of the movie. I'm just like, this is a different thing now, and I'm sort of lost at this point. But like, it's fun and hokey for the first... Yeah, I would say half of the movie.
Right.
But yeah, that's generally my strong immediate feelings about it. And anything else is more on a scene-by-scene basis.
Yeah, so. I don't really know if there's much to add before jumping in. I guess I'm just excited that, you know, we did this movie and then preparing for the Gorgon, you know, and thinking about that movie, just talking about, you know, in our previous episode, how much that relies on a comparable structure. I'm really glad we're doing these movies back-to-back because I think... if you did a double feature, it's like, wow, these movies are so similar in so many different ways. And their point of divergence seems to be like about gender in a lot of ways.
Yes.
And I think that's going to be a really fun conversation for us to have today, just going back and forth and being like, you know, this is kind of using the same sort of idea as like a narrative device with the possession on the full moon. But also just, I don't know, it doesn't have Peter Cushing or Christopher Lee. But that also makes it kind of interesting as one of these Hammer horror movies from this sort of like early prime heyday period.
Yeah. And it does leave room open to appreciate other characters in the movie.
Sure.
But we'll get to that.
So yeah, I don't have any clever jokes or transitions. How about you, Max?
I was going to make a Warren Zevon Werewolves of London reference, but I couldn't figure out how to work it into there. So, I don't know. Let's
just howl.
Okay, folks, here we go. Universal International. Registered trademark.
Okay.
That was it. That was my grand opening, everybody. But yeah, here we are with Curse of the Werewolf. I love the Hammer font. It's just...
I mean, this is not a normal font they used.
And I've seen it on numerous things, though, posters.
Well, fine. Fine. Disagree with me. But yes, the eyes. The shot of the eyes. I like this font, too, by the way.
Yeah.
I'm just arguing with you because people enjoy that. And I think it's interesting we begin with this image because it also starts something that we'll compare. We'll go back around to the Gorgon, right? Both of these movies, they both end with sort of mirror images of what happens in the beginning, right? Where we're going to open this movie with him crying, and then we're going to get the shot of the bells first to help establish this town. And then we're eventually going to end with the bells being the area where he's shot and killed. And then we see his dad look down on him, and he's crying again.
Darn.
But yes. So that's the first thing that I noticed as like a comparison. And then there's plenty others. Again, the obvious thing is just the full moon being the device that triggers like possession, right?
Yeah, sorry. I was distracted by the fact that the guy who did special effects for this movie was named Les Bowie, which is the secret love child of Les Paul and David Bowie that nobody knew about, and he went to work in special effects.
That's a bizarre pairing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Spain.
Yes, welcome to Spain.
Nowhere in particular in
Spain.
Oh,
fuck. I forgot to look up the movie that we're going to make when they had these...
Oh, right, because this is a reused set, you said?
Yeah, and I think, look at that shot. That's fucking beautiful. I think visually this movie, especially in the beginning, really differentiates itself.
When we were talking to each other about what we thought of the movie on a repeat viewing, I was saying how like early on I was just like, oh wow, they're doing non-Hammer things, because a lot of Hammer movies are just like mid shots for a lot of it because it still feels very theatrical,
right?
But they do early on in the movie, they do a lot of like great high angle, low angle landscape shots, or not landscape, but like building establishment.
We do get
shots.
Some neat landscape shots though, yeah, that really have like visual weight to them too. I'll point one out. It's like a classic shot that you see a lot in a lot of Westerns of like silhouetted against the horizon. It's like this.
Yeah.
It's a very American thing usually because it's like the idea of like, I don't know, turning the landscape into abstract shapes. It's like a James Fenimore Cooper type of thing that, you know, people use in Westerns, but it also really works for like folktale stories, right? Just putting somebody as a silhouette against the skyline or whatever. But already we're seeing interesting things that sort of trend in that direction, right? This is an interesting movie because it has the narration. So far, none of the Hammer movies we've done have that narration. And I have to be honest, I think I noticed what is actually a huge confusing plot hole literally 2 seconds ago in that narration, where it begins with about 200 years ago, although the narrator is supposedly the surrogate father. But then this beggar who was alive 200 years ago is actually Leon's father. Yeah. Somebody's fucking lying. That's what I'm saying. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe he didn't say that. But it said 200 years ago. Oh, whatever. There's other things to talk about other than that. Plenty to talk about here. But I think part of the interesting thing you're talking about with the camera movement and everything gets to the structural stuff, which we'll talk about a lot. But the idea that, okay, comparing it to theater is a good place to start. I think this movie is interesting compared to the other Hammer movies because it takes more of a novel type approach to the structure of its story compared to the rest of Hammer movies, which have more of those like unities, those dramatic unities that you see at place more in theater. And of course it has to do with the fact of what theater is compared to a novel, right? Theater, you have to change sets and everything if you're going to change scenes and stuff like that. Whereas a novel, if you're good at writing, you can jump from one point to the next, to the next, to the next, and it can be seamless and you can tell a really good story. And I think this movie maybe part of the reason why the structure is off-putting to you, and I'm sure other people, and to me, even in some ways, is just that even though it's interesting they make that decision, they still have those instincts of having the theatrical type of story play out as well. And here's that shot we mentioned.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I was more laughing at the scene prior where the guy's talking about how they've been ordered to celebrate and be happy for the wedding. And this is just...
God damn it. I'd be annoyed if somebody ordered me to do that.
Mandatory fun.
By the way, just want to point out a quick fun fact here about this Marquis character, who I assume is a Marquis, even though they call him like Marquez.
I think
it's
so.
Like, but is it his name? Or it's just he's a Marquis?
I think that they read something and were just like, that's
well,
his name.
You probably won't recognize this actor because he's got that wig on, but we've seen him before. Do you know where?
No.
Dial M for Murder.
Of course.
He's the would-be murderer who gets stabbed by scissors by Grace Kelly. who herself became a princess, which is kind of like a marquee. So it all comes back around.
Also, why would you ever serve goose that way?
Well, that's what his new bride is going to say, and he's going to get really mad.
Yeah.
That's the other interesting thing about this movie. Again, if we're doing these Hammer movies, these Terrence Fisher movies, big thing with Terrence Fisher is the way he treats these patriarchal authority figures, right? And I think this movie is very interesting in that regard, because more so than the other two we've seen so far, although Curse of Frankenstein is pretty, I don't know, it does not have a good view of what wealth allows Frankenstein to do in that movie. But it's interesting because literally in this one, it's like, these rich people were just such assholes that they invented the monster.
Yeah.
They created the monster by being such fucking pricks. This Marquis specifically. And there's some interesting parallels between what the Marquis ends up being later in the first act and just actually the image of the werewolf himself. But there's other interesting things we've seen already too that are worth bringing up. So we begin with the sort of image of the beggar arriving, right? And then I think, you know, in Terrence Fisher's worldview and just the worldview of a lot of these Hammer movies, they operate on a very moralistic, basic level. And I think the beggar is supposed to be this very innocent character at first who then, you know, has no pretense of asserting authority, but is at the whim of everyone. So how they treat him reflects entirely on them.
Yeah.
Right?
It's like, well, that's a common trope.
Sure.
I mean, like, I want to go super simple. You have like the inciting incident in like classic tale of Beauty and the Beast, where you have like the person, the enchantress, disguised in an ugly thing.
Oh, yeah, sure.
It's like, oh, that's your thing. You treat ugly and poor terribly. That's who you really are.
And that's a natural comparison to make.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what a lot of this is, right? It's the continuity between the beast on the inside and then becoming a monster, right? And that is at play both in Beauty and the Beast a little bit more explicitly, but also in this movie, just in terms of how it handles the werewolf, the idea of the werewolf. But I think it's interesting because, I don't know, it's like, I was trying to figure out what this movie's opinion of rich people actually is. And also because of the way this movie tells its story and its structure, and the fact that the beggar gets implicated in the creation of the curse as well, in the rape scene that we'll get to. And we'll talk about that when it happens. But I mean, it's interesting because it confuses the idea of like origin for this curse, right? Obviously, this rich guy is behaving like an asshole.
Yeah.
And we get some pretty like somewhat on the nose lines from the, don't treat him like an animal. He's a human, not an animal, right? That idea pops up several times in the dialogue. But it's complicated by the fact that it's like the curse is created by both of them, you know?
Yeah. Sorry. I'm thinking about multiple things here. One, it's like comical, but not comical, of just like how cruel rich people would be. But also like, I'm just thinking about, because like I did say, I love the costume design in this movie. It's very like standard period piece type thing, but it's shiny, it's extravagant, it's fun. But I'm thinking about, because like we were talking about gendering during our pre-discussion of this.
Yeah.
And it is interesting that like this fashion was like considered the most masculine thing possible at the time. Like you had to wear high heels and white leggings to show off your calves, and that was like the most manly thing of all.
And then men were like, well, how about we just let the women do this?
This is a lot of effort.
Yes. And I would really appreciate pockets. Can we get a vote on the pockets? But no pockets for women. Listen, we have to be better than them. But yes, I think it's interesting too, now that you're bringing up the gender at play here, because this is a big part of this movie, especially in comparing it to the Gorgon, that is more interesting to me. Like that comparison is like a lot of it, the points of divergence are just the gender of the monster. And it's interesting because werewolves are, you know, seemingly gendered masculine much more frequently than a lot of other monsters, which seem to be coded for different feminine things. More so than masculine
With the
things.
Exception of Howling too. Your sister's a werewolf.
Of course. That's the whole point of that movie. Just to remind you
that your sister is a werewolf.
Finally, a woman can be a werewolf. But no, I think this movie, again, it mixes it up a little bit. It's a very conservative movie, much like The Gorgon. But I think it does not pathologize women in quite the same way. In fact, there's quite a few moments, but we actually get moments in this movie where like women are shown to have their own desires and agency, especially with the daughter character later on who winds up defying her father, right?
Yeah.
I think that's a lot more than you get in The Gorgon. But I think the different genders, like, it has interesting implications of why they choose to tell the story this way. And I think it relates to a lot of those ideas from, like, Men, Women, and Chainsaws, Clover's book that we talk about all the time, about, like, you know, her chapter on how women are open in a lot of ways, and they're perceived as more, in a lot of these different horror movies, as being more close to possession, more vulnerable to possession or like contamination by the foreign object that is monstrosity, right?
Yeah.
They're closer to the abject. But it's interesting that this movie doesn't quite go in that direction 100%. I still think there's certain things about the way the werewolf curse originates that allows it to be read as like feminization. But it's not nearly as straightforward as The Gorgon, where it's really just like, it's like a one-to-one street between like Medusa and then the vulnerable woman, right?
It's Megara.
Pardon me. Yeah, Megara.
The incorrect name.
Here's an interesting moment that relates to this. So if you're not watching it along with us, this is the moment the beggar fucks himself, where I think he could have left even now and gotten away just fine. But then he says thank you to the Marquis after the Marquis is leaving with his bride. And then he sort of leers at both of them and then says, have a good night.
Yeah.
And that's just not acceptable to say that.
Because he knows you're going to fuck.
Yes. But the interesting thing about that.
Nobody's allowed to fuck in Spain at this time period.
Well, here's the thing. Let's relate it to all these other, you know, Terrence Fisher movies. And then also The Gorgon specifically.
Okay.
One thing that Terrence Fisher seems to be, and by Terrence Fisher, I also mean just the team of people who make these movies, seem to be very preoccupied with, is that monstrosity is very directly tied to like Oedipal relationships. And by that, I mean the way in which, you know, in a lot of different stories or just even in society for a long time, the idea of asserting selfhood as a young man through the acquisition romantically and sexually of women. Right?
Okay.
Specifically, the acquisition of them from the father, the exchange from one to the next, right? And in a lot of, it's a very vague connection, but it still makes sense. It's like in a lot of movies where men have to work out their identity through their relationship to a woman, that's like a vaguely Oedipal progression because the woman is the thing that allows them to assert their selfhood. It's like manic pixie dream girls are annoying because they're not real people. They're just like repositories for like the guy's character arc. And that's also part of what Clover talks about in that chapter of her book. And I think the same thing is at play in both The Gorgon and this movie, although Terrence Fisher is, one of the things he does is both these movies are like the monstrosity invades, right? And then it disrupts the normal ability for that, you know, development to happen. And then the male character dies or they go crazy, right? Or they turn into a werewolf, right? This is what happens in these movies.
More beast than man. We have the girl who's literally unable to talk.
Yes.
Which is, if we're going to talk about female agency and...
I mean, she's pretty like, she's basically just like this. I think for this movie, she's basically created as like the most innocent object possible.
She's doe-eyed cleavage. Like,
right, exactly. That's exactly what it is. And it's like she only exists to, I think there's two things going on. I think they want to show the Leon Oliver Reed character as this young man who is a normal young man, but still gets invaded by this monstrosity. So part of it is that in telling the story this way, they feel the need to use this as this like justification to explain how he could be contaminated. You know what I mean? So it's like the only way even for him, the only way to like contaminate him is through a woman, because the woman is the one that's open to the curse.
Yeah.
The priest describes it later as an accident of birth or whatever. So again, the only way he's vulnerable is through his mother. And that's really the only reason she exists in this movie. And part of the reason why I think she's so doe-eyed is because she exists. Her innocence is only there to be like a foil to better demonstrate, you know, these characters and their depravity, really.
Yeah. Also, his face got very gray.
Yeah. His bodily decay, right? And that's all about him being like the Marquis with like excessive desire. That's the big thing about this movie, I think, too, is like, you know, the werewolf is this thing of like unregulated desire. And I haven't really brought it up yet, but there's a whole thing in this movie about relating to the idea of the primal scene, Freud's primal scene, which actually came from a case file that people famously call the Wolfman. And the idea of like, he describes it as a scene as a child before you've like entered gender in your mind, but yeah. You see like a sexual act and that it creates anxiety for you because it's enigmatic and you don't understand. But part of that too sets up the Oedipal drive, because you see something you don't understand and it gives you anxieties about like castration and this stuff. I'm not like a Freud expert, and I find Freud like less interesting, but I think it's interesting how it relates here, because visually there's so many different moments where you see people gazing at objects of desire behind the bars of a crib, so to speak. We already had it in this cell with the beggar looking at her, then looking at the food. But then also you had it with the Marquis looking at her through his house of cards.
Yeah. Didn't even notice the parallels there.
Very, you know, it's kind of bizarre when you reflect on that image. It's like, why is he hiding behind a deck of cards stacked in the house?
Well, I guess if my face had turned gray in old age, I would try to build things to hide behind as well.
Yes. And then, like, I think it's, again, interesting when you look at, like, what's the similarity now between the Marquis and the beggar is that they have this unregulated desire that makes them animals, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing that, you know, Terrence Fisher kind of pathologizes in this movie, compared to the last one where it's more like specifically women and female sexuality is pathologized. And he's like, I'm paranoid about this shit. In this one, he's more paranoid about like desire in general. Right.
Yeah. But it's less like, it's less a criticism of the gender of where it's coming from. Wherein like,
right.
Female desire as portrayed in these movies is like,
it kind of doesn't exist.
It's a terrible thing if it does. And yeah, otherwise it doesn't. Women are just pure objects for evil forces to
right.
do with as they wish.
But again, it kind of does exist in this movie later with the daughter. So I, again, very conservative, all these movies and their like outlook on like sex and gender. But I think it also creates ambiguities in different moments, which makes it interesting. And then I think the other part of that House of Cards image, just to go back to that, is like, you know, to relate this idea of this Oedipal cycle that then is interrupted and then derailed by the presence of monstrosity. I think part of the thing that scares Terrence Fisher, and he has in a lot of his movies, is like ineffectual and impotent, you know, traditional patriarchal figures of authority. Right?
Yeah.
So you have this unregulated desire of the Marquis, but what does it do? It destroys his wife and then makes him kind of impotent. And then also makes him a bad, bad leader in this position of authority.
Yes.
And makes him look like a pirate, kind of.
He looks like Ebenezer Scrooge.
That's, yeah. Yeah, definitely. And it's funny you say that, because the one other thing I was going to compare the structure of this movie to was like that type of Victorian novel, where it's like there's a lot of similar elements to it, where there's so many times in those novels where, you know, you have elements where it's like, you know, somebody is like switched at birth or whatever, right? And then it's like, oh, this weird like Dickensian horrifying adventure where you're a child laborer, even though you inherit a bunch of wealth, but you don't actually know. And then your evil crooked like nanny is trying to take it from you. You know what I mean? It's always interesting things like that. And the other interesting thing about comparing it to those like Victorian novels is how it's like they contrast different ideas of like public versus private information and space, where it's like a lot of those books are like about the drama comes from like people seeing something that they think demonstrates a person's guilt. And then the person is ostracized and has terrible consequences on their life.
Yeah. So like if we're going with that type of thing with this story, though, you think that like the beggar, if we're doing like a standard morality play about how like desire and greed like will turn you into a beast or something like that, you think like the beggar, despite being in the cell for so long, like he would have been kinder to her or something like that.
That's where the issue of like its origin becomes strange. Yeah. Because it splits it between the two of them. And it's like, you could technically cut one of those out, right? So why is it both? I think part of it too, even though it's a little bit confusing, it reinforces that like primal scene moment where you're, again, think of yourself, and you can also maybe compare it to the Lacanian stuff that we talk about in different episodes, specifically Eraserhead. I think we'd give a decent explanation of it there. But the idea that like, you know, that's where the creation of desire comes from, but it comes from that sense of lack, right? So the metaphorical crib cage becomes the like prison bars, right?
Yeah.
That separate you from the thing you want. And since that image shows up so many times in this movies, I feel like that's part of its take on the werewolf thing, is like the werewolf is like, overload. It's like an overload, right? So it's a combination of the fact that, you know, the Leon character feels like he's unable to actually get the thing he wants, like he's trapped behind bars, but also the fact that he wants it so much and those things feeding one another. And then it results in the werewolf.
But she can't speak.
Yeah. And it's also like, it's interesting to just look at these two, like compare this character to the Barbara Shelley character from the Gorgon, where they both have this weird thing that prevents them from being able to actually have any sort of awareness in certain ways, or like responsibility in what's going on. Like one of the things we talked about in the Gorgon is we thought it would probably be more interesting if the Barbara Shelley had some interiority and
agency.
Well, just that, like, she had her own opinion on what was going on instead of just being like, it's awful.
Yeah.
When she only learns at the end. And it's like, what if she enjoyed it? You know, what if she was like, I kind of like
this. I get a rush from being a Gorgon and killing gross men because, look, I've been locked in this hospital my entire fucking life.
Right.
By this
But crazy instead, she's doctor. An amnesiac.
Yeah.
And we just watched this woman kill someone. And then we never know anything about what she feels or what she thinks about it because she's mute.
Yeah.
I do think that's a very nice expressive use of that red, though. Some of that classic Hammer color use right there. And definitely, I think, with Terrence Fisher's movies specifically, the bright red shows up as like a motif he uses to sort of, I don't know, associate things with the incoming supernatural or gothic stuff. Now, Max,
that pipe.
I was going to say, if you pay attention to that pipe, you might notice.
It's from National Treasure.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's the same pipe.
So I think it's interesting to look at this movie and think, really, this guy's a Freemason.
Yes.
In Spain.
How does that change? Well, no, yeah. Spain had the most wealth in Europe for a while, so it would make sense they got the Templar treasure.
Yeah.
Before the English took it to America and Benjamin Franklin wrote a letter to his brother when he was 15 about it.
Is silence do good?
Yeah.
Which is the name of that mute character.
You don't have proof it's not.
You know what we should call her? Mary.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very Christian Spanish name, so why not?
Well, also because there's the whole thing where it gets very blatant when we see the baby for the first time. Yeah. But the fact that it's like, she's saying right now, it's like, you don't want a baby to be born the same day as the Lord. It's a bastardization of Jesus's birthday.
Is an insult to heaven? Okay, well, what do you want to do? Just tell her to hold it in for a bit?
The funny thing about the way this actor plays it is that he almost seems to be like thinking that. It's like, what the fuck do you want me to do about it? You know what else is interesting about this situation too is that these two characters are not married.
Yeah, I guess not.
She's his, like...
nanny? Servant?
Yeah, well, I don't know what the term would be.
Man-child nanny?
Yeah, she helps him keep the house. But they act sort of in a way you would... They both take on that surrogate parenting role, right? And it becomes interesting because it's... I felt like originally when I started rewatching this movie, like, there's a ritual to try to make it safe or whatever.
I know Spanish, like, Catholicism has, like, a bunch of, like, really weird eclectic stuff that, like, varies province by province.
Right.
But, like, every time I see just, like, certain things, I'm just like, where did this even come from?
Well, also, too, it's like, do I really trust whatever? This is not Spanish Catholicism. This is Anthony Hines, who wrote the screenplay under a pseudonym of John Elder. He's like, what's some mystical things?
Well, I know, like, there's, like, one town in Spain, if, like, they have a festival the week before Lent where they just, like, have a parade and they throw dirt and fire ants at everybody. It's just, like, a big thing they do.
Can we do that in Washington?
Yeah, just co-opt that tradition.
Yeah.
Throwing dirt and fire ants at everybody.
Oh, man. That reminds me of a great story on the Aguirre Wrath of God commentary track with Werner Herzog casually talking about how he accidentally, like, chopped down a tree or something to clear a path, and then just with his, like, little machete, and then he's like, and then the fire ants rained down on me and they ate me alive. Oh, man, that made me laugh so hard when I heard that.
That pipe, yeah, it's fancy, but, like, I feel like it would be, like, really heavy to hold in your mouth just to, like, casually puff on.
But it's worth it if it holds the secret to the Templar treasure.
Yeah, but then you would definitely not want to smoke out of it, because, like...
No, you definitely do want to smoke out of it to confuse your enemies. You don't know how to do this, Max.
I know, but what if, like, tobacco residue gets stuck in one of the key parts and it makes it not open the secret Templar
door? They're masons. They know how to make it in such a way that that would never happen. Okay. It's waterproof. It's... what
it's
else?
It's gunpowder proof.
Yeah, it is...
It's Nicolas Cage proof. They just knew. They're just like, there's going to be an insane person who's carrying around this pipe.
Oh, there's the obvious comparison. Literally the image of Mary in a painting. And then we shift focus, and then we get the little baby of Leon. But yeah, so lots of interesting things going on with that. And just to get back to the whole thing I was starting to bring up, I think it's interesting that she's his maid, because it reintroduces some of that, like, black magic and white science dichotomy that we talk about, which also comes from Men, Women, and Chainsaw.
Yes.
Where, you know, a common thing that happens in a lot of these possession or horror movies that Clover talks about is the idea of first trying to solve the problem with science, which is coded as white establishment.
Wow. They just know she's dead real quick.
But yeah, they didn't even have to look.
They didn't check her pulse or anything.
Oh, this scene is fucking hilarious, by the way. But yeah, so everybody tries to solve it with white science at first. The rationalist approach, right?
Yeah.
And then when that doesn't work, they end up turning to the black magic, which is always the solution of whichever, you know, other community monster it belongs to. It could be anything, as long as it's not white establishment, really.
White male establishment.
Yes, that too. It's
very important, because the witchcraft is obviously most associated with females for a lot.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting to mention that, because it made me wonder, like, okay, so this movie, I was thinking about it. This is just so great. I have to interrupt myself. They're going to baptize the baby, and then this miracle happens, and they're all just like, well, okay.
This is Catholic Spain. This happens a lot.
I mean, look at the dad's, like, facial reactions. It's just like, and then the priest, it's like, well...
Also, if this baby is, like, a cursed werewolf child, like, wouldn't baptizing it be good, though?
That's what I would think.
Like, isn't that supposed to cleanse the evil or whatnot?
They kind of go in that direction, but I think it also has to do with the idea of enforcing regulation on it, right? So the only solution for him is to live in this tragic state of complete lack, which is epitomized by the pre-suggestion that he go become a monk and live in a monastery.
Oh, they're doing the pussy baptism. They're supposed to power dunk the baby into the thing.
I'm just thinking of when they introduce automation into baptisms. That'll be great.
Well, I know there are those like televangelist preachers who will do just like a bunch of like baptisms at once. So they'll just be like, boof.
You know, I have a
baby after baby after baby.
I have a serious problem at work.
Oh no, that ghost stuffed animal got some ketchup on it.
Yeah, it did. I have a problem at work where in moments where I don't have anything to do, I just go down these rabbit holes of like watching those televangelist like exorcism videos.
Oh yeah.
I just love them. So great.
Imagine like that level of like physical like force and like vigor applied to a baptism, and that's pretty much that level of things. It's wonderful.
Oh God, I love these people so much. But anyway, the point I was going to make earlier about it being interesting that he's you know, he's somebody who is invoking the rationalist white science, and then she's his maid who invokes the black magic, is that it also has class implications. And I sort of felt watching it for the first time this week again that it sort of loses track of the obvious class stuff going on in the beginning. But what really happens is that it starts off very blatant and then it just becomes a little bit more subtle. You know,
yeah.
It's not like it necessarily loses track of it, but it just, it is not the comical, like mustache twirling rich marquee the same way it is in the beginning. And I think part of it, part of an interesting question to ask in this is like, is the father figure an aristocrat?
Kind of.
He has a maid. He's definitely wealthier than she is.
Yeah, he had a spare bedroom to put her in and like just sort of took her in and took care of her.
Yeah.
He found her in a river and he's like, well, I'm a rich person this time period. I guess this is what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
This is my hobby now. But yeah, is his role ever like explicitly? I don't know.
Oh, here we have little boy Leon.
Yeah.
Little Damien.
Yeah, I was just going to say. I mean, this came out, this was before The Omen, so it's not like it's...
Again, it's an apt comparison, though.
Yeah.
The mother figure in this is the one that has the original greater awareness of the curse for Damien, right? And then that movie is Gregory Peck actually learning the truth and then being too late to do anything about it. That entire movie is that woman talking about how something is wrong and then no one fucking listening to her until she gets like murdered.
Yeah.
And this movie, it's the same sort of arc. The father is the rationalist approach who does not listen to
the mother. The thing I like about The Omen is that like it requires a little bit of suspension, but like technically nothing supernatural ever happens in The Omen, and you can technically read it all as like rational thing, but it's just like
technically.
Yes, but that's the whole thing. It's just like these things keep happening and they keep going down. And
I feel like that's Richard Donner's opinion on the movie. And I'm like, but you didn't make that movie because even if that was the case, there's certain things like it's just about like what we see. There are like camera moment things where I'm like, why are you showing us a close up of Damien now?
Yeah.
If not to imply that separate of like the dad's like paranoia about it, that it's actually real. Also, I know baboons are dangerous, but do they really just freak out and murder everything?
They are violent.
They are. That's why they made that classic movie, Chakma.
Chakma!
That was lame. That was terrible.
Okay, then you Chakma.
I'll add the real one in editing.
Okay. You're making a lot of work for yourself in the editing job this
time. That's how I make money.
I'll throw in an extra hay penny on your salary.
Thank you so much. 10 pesetas like that beggar. Yeah. Thank you, Maxx. And of course, here's another interesting thing we can compare to the Gorgon, the idea that, you know, in both of these movies, the monstrous presence in this town makes everything
strawberry.
Go wrong.
I hate strawberry.
Sorry. Like, sir, it's jam.
I know I've talked about the hammer blood before, and this movie has a lot of it.
It's great.
I can take it less seriously in this movie just because a lot of times it's just sort of lying on a puppet or on the ground. And I'm just like, that's...
I do love their use of it at the end.
Yeah.
Where I think really the, you know, I don't think we get quite the same explosive shot with it, like with Dracula, but the wolf, when he's transformed and he's got the blood coming out his mouth, I think it works about just as well as the Dracula stuff. Maybe not as well, but I think it's a really great image still. Oh, here's a good moment to bring back, connect back to that Victorian novel conversation and the way this movie uses pubs. It's interesting because the generational divide like allows you perspective on like public versus private space, but also public versus private narrative that culminates in us, you know, identifying with these individuals that are Leon's family in the crowd, the mob crowd, and then also having the contrast of the mob trying to kill him. And it's good for creating, you know, tragic stories because it's about like social miscues, right? We all know Leon is innocent, really, and that it's really the Marquis and the beggar who are guilty.
Yeah, but...
But it's just interesting because, you know...
It's the son being punished for the sins of the fathers, like...
Yeah.
Which is... Fuck that. And also, like, that woman did nothing wrong.
Yeah, I mean, the woman thing is, like, very bizarre. And we talked over the rape scene. I know we've talked over... I mean, we didn't... Let me start over. We talked over the rape scene, and I know we've talked in a number of different episodes on our opinion of, like, when rape shows up in a lot of different movies. Specifically not exploitation movies, I think, because we can pretty easily feel like we can dismiss a lot of those. It's like things we were like, do not agree with. It's more in like less exploitative movies or movies that have aspirations of not being exploitative. And then when it shows up as like a little speed bump in the plot, it's like, excuse me, is rape really like a speed bump in the plot? Yeah. You know, like if you're going to do that, you have to be very careful about how you're going to make that work because it's so ubiquitous in movies, right? It's like, can we not do this? Is my thought almost every single time when a rape happens in a movie. And in this, I think it's the same way, right? There's really no point to that character, right? And the only reason that she's like raped, I mean, there's like, I'm trying to think about why could it not just be that he had an evil mother who also participated in the extravagances of the Marquis?
Yeah, like you already, they make the big deal about the Marquis getting married and have like that character show compassion or whatnot. And the movie just kills that character off screen and it doesn't seem...
You mean the wife?
Yeah.
Of the Marquis? I think part of the answer to the question I just asked is that it's trying to define the curse itself and what happens when you're the werewolf along more like masculine lines. So it's like, it's not like coming from a woman in this movie so much as it is coming from a man, but it has to go through the woman to get at another man. You know, that's another difference between this and the Gorgon, where it's like the Gorgon doesn't feel the need to really justify why that character is open to possession. It's just that she's a woman and she's more open. Men are closed.
And there's no other
women are open.
There's no other woman in that town besides the crazy
right.
Mental patient and the nurse who got attacked by that crazy mental patient.
Yeah, so I don't know.
The movie doesn't have a wonderful opinion of women.
No, as we discussed last time. Horrified of them. He's got a problem. He's going to have to shave his hands.
Oh, fuck. He's going to have the talk with him. He's going through puberty.
Yeah, people always give that explanation for werewolves, and I understand it. This movie definitely is about, I think, desire and psychosexual desire. But I don't know, reducing it to puberty is kind of too easy. I think in a lot of instances, unless you're watching, I don't know, Teen Wolf.
Yeah, I guess.
Or Alvin and the Chipmunks versus the werewolf.
But now this leads me into a good question.
What?
So you mentioned Teen Wolf.
Okay. They don't play basketball in this, so...
No, unfortunately. But I brought this up last time, because Teen Wolf was popular, and a lot of people were like, yeah, I want to fuck a werewolf, and you had the Twilight thing. What would your ideal monster fucking partner be, Austin?
For me?
Yes.
What monster would I want to fuck?
Yes.
Oh, my God. I don't even know if I have an answer to that question, like, that I've thought about. I prefer to just have a nice person in real life that I could fuck.
No. Yes, it has to be a monster.
That requires enough imagination as it is. Okay.
Well, you got like the standard. You got vampire. Everybody wants to fuck vampires.
But vampires are just people.
Yeah.
Like
they're people with sharp fangs and a flair for the dramatic.
And it's just a pain in the ass because there's so many things you just like can't do. You have to do all the errands because things will close at night and you have to go pick up the groceries.
And they
all
have
the
to
time.
Keep asking if they can be allowed inside the CVS.
Yes. It's just so fucking annoying. You have to get the manager just to go inside.
Yeah.
I'd like to speak with your manager. Ma'am, you haven't eaten here yet. Save your complaints, please. No, no, no. I'm a vampire. Oh, I'm sorry.
Countess Karen.
Oh, my God. I can't. That sounds like an SNL sketch waiting to be ruined by those hacks. Unless you're hiring SNL.
In which case, you have put out nothing but quality entertainment.
In which case, you've been putting out shit and you need someone to fix it. And I know who. I know who.
Andy Sandberg. Oh, wait.
Oh, no, he left.
Greener pastures.
Yeah. Well, here's another great instance of that Terrence Fisher, like, you know, moralizing figure, where the priest is the closest thing we get to, like, that authority actually being effective.
I love how the priest is just like, oh, I know what you have here. This is a classic case of werewolf.
Yeah, he does seem to have this information out of nowhere.
And I guess it's supposed to be like a priest, so he's familiar with evil beings and whatnot. But like, I've read the Bible. There ain't like the subsection of just like, yo, so if your child's exhibiting these symptoms, he's probably a werewolf.
I'm imagining it like a WikiHow guide with pictures.
Maybe it's in that Demon's Hammer or the Witch's
Hammer.
Witch's Hammer. Yeah.
What is the full title of it?
I think it just translates.
No, from there's Latin a to the there's another Hammer. There's another thing to it. Malleus Maleficarum, I think, just means witch's hammer.
Yeah.
But then there's another part of the title that is like very just long-winded about like how to destroy them and
well, a lot of it was
make sure they're dead.
A lot of it was added after because that book, like, I know books weren't a big thing, but like that was after the invention of the printing press. So like that was the number two selling book in all of Europe after the Bible.
Yeah.
How to fucking burn wishes. And a lot of it was added on afterwards because people started lighting women on a fire and then started sharing ideas on the most effective ways to light women on fire. That was networking before networking.
You got to go to these events, man. You got to network. This is how you get work.
It's not about burning the witch. It's about talking with other famous witch burners.
And yeah.
Getting your name out there.
Listen, did you make cards? Make some cards, some contact cards, right? You're Steve. You live out by the mill. They can't call you or fax you or anything. But at least they know where you are.
This is 100% the same pub as the...
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is. That's what's interesting about it is, again, you have that public and private narrative. You have the guy who, you know, claimed he shot the dog or whatever. And then we see that relationship develop over years. It's stock characters and it's barely explored, but it's there, right?
Yeah.
I think that's part of the unfortunate thing about this structure is that it introduces this interesting idea about how to tell this story is something that's simultaneously private and public. But then, you know, because they still want to kind of be like other Hammer movies, they're just a little bit too cozy with the theatrical to really feel like they sell the characters as fully fleshed out, you know? Like, I don't really remember anything about this Hunter, but he's actually like, these characters have like different, they have like start origin points and then destinations that they go on, right? And it lasts multiple generations. This Hunter has the silver bullet that he keeps around his neck that winds up being the thing that kills Leon.
Yeah.
Right? But there's nothing about like him individually that I really remember aside from the fact that they want to tell that story. Because I think what Hammer's go-to move for that was just cast an interesting actor, you know?
Yeah.
To compensate for writing that maybe isn't as good.
Which, yeah, no, that it's evident in some of their movies, especially like the fact that people even paid to see the later Dracula movies was a testament to Christopher Lee's presence.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, that's another interesting thing that this movie, it's a classic Hammer thing, but a character that has no words. It's different between Dracula and the Mary character, but like, now that I think about it, that's something they kind of do frequently. It's like, oh God, how do we have as little dialogue and terrible writing as possible? Well, I'll just make this character not talk. But it's Dracula. Well, he doesn't want to talk anyway. So he'll be happier. Christopher Lee will love it.
He gets to pay to develop his new electrical guitar.
What?
No. This is making a joke how old he was when he got into metal. But.
Oh, yeah. By the way, confirmation on that weird error in just, I can't believe they made that mistake with the voiceover, where at the beginning he says about 200 years ago, that beggar. And then later on he says, and I found her in the river.
Yeah.
So both of those things cannot be true. No. Unless this is also a Dracula movie and we don't understand yet.
And everybody's a vampire.
No, just him.
No, just everybody is. That's why.
Oh, that's why they age so slowly?
Yeah. That girl was actually, like, that beggar had been in prison for, like, a solid 100
long
years.
Time, yeah. Yeah.
That would be an interesting twist. This is the secret underworld prequel that we never knew, where vampires have a dominant society and werewolves are a shunned other. We should do an underworld movie eventually.
I think we could. Those are the type of movies that feel kind of like surface level, like trashy or whatever.
Well, that's the thing about underworld is, like, I've seen every underworld movie.
Okay.
And they are bad, but, like, there's a good movie underneath there. And I'd like, the reason I keep seeing them is because I, like, enjoy yelling at the screen and just being like, you're so close to the thing that could have been an interesting movie, and you just decided to take it in the dumbest possible direction in so many things.
Yeah. I mean, not only that, but I feel like when I watch movies that way, I'm also like, it's not just reacting that way, but also it's like, yeah, but nobody notices this about you except for me. And they should.
Yeah.
Because you're special, underworld. I don't know. I feel a weird desire to want to do those movies. Again, here we have more of that imagery that is definitely very evocative of, like, Freud in the primal scene, right, where the child has not yet experienced, you know, their conception of gender in relation to themselves, but then they perceive a sexual act, usually in these different ideas of the primal scene, it's the parents, right, but they see it somehow when they shouldn't. And then they don't understand it, so they perceive it kind of as violence as well. They don't understand what it is. And it's confusing and creates anxiety.
Oh, they killed a doggo.
But also creates desire in a weird way. So it's this mixture of those two things. And, yeah, helps set up things like, you know, Freud's idea of castration complex and the Oedipal complex.
But he's
here we have
father.
Oliver Reed making his entrance. This is his first starring role.
Really?
Oliver Reed, yes. And he would go on to be in a number of Hammer movies.
He was in a lot of movies in general.
He was.
I believe the total count comes over 100. But
he was definitely one of those actors.
Yeah.
And I think, again, part of the thing that allowed him to maybe do that is that he was very good at playing specific types of bizarre, crazy, yet charismatic people. I think maybe the best example of that is in The Brood, where, speaking of Freud, he's doing some insane, like, psychosexual therapy with these people, pretending to be their daddy.
Yeah.
It's like, daddy loves you, doesn't he? Does he? But does he? That movie's so great. But he's a very bizarre guy and definitely fucking monster to work with in person. What a nutcase. Yeah. I actually found a pretty good podcast episode about it before we even decided to do Hammer, I think over the summer, listening to it. And actually, do you know about his cock?
No.
Okay. Well, fun detail. So he had a tattoo of an eagle on his shoulder, right? And then at, like, crazy parties or whatever, he'd be like, do you want to know where it roosts? And then he'd zip his fly down and he'd show you that he got a tattoo of talons on his cock. And then wave his cock around in the air.
Sure.
This happened.
I don't doubt it.
But he's the type of crazy person who's like, I think, I don't even know what to say about him. Like, he just had he always said that he was, like, very gentle, but it's like, that's not true, dude. He was very fragile and also hyper masculine. So in some ways, very appropriate to play this role, right? Because part of the thing we talked over with the priest's explanation of him is, like, this idea that the priest says only love can save him. And maybe he will fall in love with a woman, but it's very important that that woman loves him, because otherwise you better watch out. Then the wolf will come out. And relating to that idea of desire and then the Oedipal process of asserting selfhood and subjectivity through the possession of a woman, right? When that doesn't happen, the werewolf comes out because his male identity is so fragile, he cannot deal with it in any other way than lashing out. And that's sort of what Oliver Reed seemed to do in real life constantly whipping his dick out for no reason.
So he's perfectly cast.
Honestly, yeah. And also he was a notorious alcoholic. So him working in a winery, again, bizarre, kind of bizarre. And yeah, I mean, I'm not here to like judge everything about his character or whatever.
Why does he need to be strong to put...
I don't know.
To fill a bottle with wine and put the label on it.
But again, here's one of the more interesting repetitions of that primal scene imagery, right? The prisoner bars of the crib separating our young hero from his object of desire, which is, of course, a woman.
But I want her.
Yep.
I need to assert my masculinity.
But at the same time, it's that very Terence Fisher-esque situation of the Oedipal exchange between the father and the son with the daughter as the object, right? If I can't get the daughter, I'm a fragile man who can't do anything. I'm destroyed.
I must unleash the beast.
Yes, exactly. And that's exactly what happens when he can't. They're trying to escape and go, and then yeah. He gets caught by the police. And that's, and again, what happens when he transforms the final time? He's trapped behind those bars again.
I think this is the part in the movie where I'm just like, okay, this is taking too long.
Yeah. But I think it's interesting how, for me, watching it this time, it's like repeating the same things that we've already seen and also interacting with that. We can speculate on whether or not his surrogate father is an aristocrat, but definitely the people he's working for are those aristocrats. And most definitely her fiance, right?
Yeah.
But it's interesting because, as we'll see throughout the rest of it, the thing that makes him, Leon, unacceptable as a partner of exchange for the father are things that result from the shitty behaviors of the Marquis and the beggar.
Yes.
Which we can say is created by that same class of people. So this movie, I think, does manage to establish that contradiction where, you know, I don't know if it goes so far as implicating the entire system, but talking about how when, you know, people abuse that system and their positions of patriarchal authority, they create these circumstances of like that are impossible to resolve for our tragic hero. And that's why he gets destroyed. Oh, I love this line. Well, it's very unfair. That's what it is. I hope you're watching it with us because you can just turn off this commentary right at that line where the fiance is upset that they have to leave gambling early. And I was winning too. It's just a great male hissy fit. And I love that.
I had a friend and her birthday is like 2 days after mine. So she's just like, oh, a bunch of our mutual friends are going to go to a casino. You should come with us and like make it a dual celebration. I'm just like, I'm not going to a casino. I don't trust that. And another one of our friends, he's a little bit older than us. He's like, nah, man, I know this casino. I've been there. This is like my stomping grounds when I was out partying a little bit when I was younger. I know this. I can teach you guys how to win money. The next day, I'm like, hey, so you coming out tonight? And he's like, I lost a lot of money at the casino, and I don't think I have enough to go out. So
I feel like a good way to think about casinos is compare it to like just think of the sentence you just said talking about maybe going and then like exchange the word for like strip bar. Oh, I think I can win a lot of money at the strip bar.
Yeah.
No, you won't. No, you will not. You will lose more money than you think.
Because it's designed to be that way.
Yeah. So I don't know. I've never done gambling or anything really.
It's very easy to win, but it's even easier to lose.
Yes.
That's the problem. No, I used to infuriate my aunts and uncles by beating them at poker when I was a small child.
Did they react the same way as this aristocratic young man?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, it's very unfair. That's what it is. You should not be winning. Now, Max, let me ask you, do you think this movie Do you think it does implicate the system or...
No.
It just implicates the individuals. Because I have to think it's the individuals.
Well, yeah, because we are shown the rich, noble person in his adoptive father that can be good and yeah. does try to do the best things for him.
And he's not as rich, clearly, as... Or I don't know, because he's also like a young man starting out on his own sort of thing, too. Where yeah. it seems like he's trying to make a name for himself without...
And the maid is just like, oh, you should stay here and just work for your father. It'll be an easy life
like,
for
no,
him.
No, I have to. I have a destiny.
Yeah.
Right?
To package wine.
So he's just starting out. So maybe he refuses the advantages that he could have had depending on the father. I don't think there's any clear signifier of the father's wealth aside from just having a maid, but I don't know if that would put him, you know... is like an aristocrat, but I think it makes them responsible, but it fails to implicate the entire system. Much like the Gorgon, it's like the problem is not the fact of these institutional, like traditional patriarchal authority figures existing as like the main governing force or whatever of this town. It's the fact that they're bad at what they're doing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but we don't. With Marquis, we see like. He's just an asshole, and he taxes his citizens too high so he can throw elaborately baked goose on the ground.
Right.
But we don't see her father being bad other than the fact that he's just like...
Disrupting their union. Yeah. Well, we definitely know the fiancé is bad because he's just an idiot rich person who, when they splash him, laughs. Right? But also, we're going to see the mayor. And I didn't pay attention to it, and I wanted to, and I'm an idiot for forgetting this. But I believe the first person the beggar meets and says, "Can't you read?" very condescendingly, is the guy who winds up being the beggar. I can't quite remember, but I think it's the same guy. So he goes on to be the mayor of this town or whatever the fuck it is. And
that could just honestly be like reusing of actors or something.
Sure, but I'm saying that... regardless of anything, it's still there. So I think the point is you see enough instances where like wealth comes into play or like the townspeople are too okay with their like, you know, the wealthy people who have like derelicted their duty in certain ways or like just not good at what they do, which allows for the monstrosity to take place much in the same way as the Gorgon, the thing that allows, oh, casino. Wow. There you go. But yeah, much in the same way as the Gorgon where we talk about that vacated, neglected castle being the thing that becomes the lair of the Gorgon. It's like the neglected patriarchal institution allows for monstrosity to thrive. And I think the same thing happens here, except, you know, the figures who allow that to happen actually end up being directly responsible for creating it instead of it coming from like, you know, an ancient myth about a Gorgon. It's like, no, you're bad at being a patriarchal authority figure, so you actually created the monster this time. But that's as far as it goes, I think. I love this image of him just sweating there. He just pushes the glass out of the way. I want to GIF this and then make it a meme for when terrible things happen. It's perfect for it, isn't it?
There's women.
It's just so funny and like over the top, like freaking out.
He's a good Christian boy. He can't see all these immoral women twirling their big old dresses around.
Yeah.
That's sin, as we see by the red lighting and it's hellfire.
Yeah. I mean, you're joking, but really what happens, right? The thing that excites his desire for the thing he can't have because of the intruding father. Is what helps trigger.
I was only half joking, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, it really is sort of going there. And then we know that he's, you know, lost the battle the moment he starts to surrender to his excessive monstrous desire that then keeps growing and growing and growing. And I think this is the closest the book or the movie gets to the book that it credits as being the source material, which I've not read, but I get the impression is very salacious compared to what they were able to get away with here. I think in that one, there's a lot more taboo, like incest things, but also there's a very bizarre moment that people talk a lot about that they compare to this moment where I believe the werewolf's mother or maybe his sister allows him to like suckle at them, but he bites their breasts because he needs blood.
Okay.
But that's a very like macabre image. And I think this is the closest the movie gets to that. I don't know. It's just another interesting detail.
Oh, God. No, let him have fun. I want some wine. We should have gotten some nice red wine.
The irony of working at a vineyard only to pay for wine. I make all my money shipping out wine.
I feel like you could probably like just slip a couple bottles in your jacket. You'd be fine.
I'm surprised he didn't. He seems like that type of guy.
I mean, when he's first introduced, it's obvious that he's drunk, I think. Sure. So it's like, he's just
partaking. I mean, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah. The office building I work in used to be, I don't know if I should say the name of the company. Well, it used to be occupied also by a company that makes like liquor and booze and stuff. And they just had like a full bar on their floor. And you could just like smell when their employees had been in the elevator like after lunch, because it's like I smell alcohol and it's very strong. It's like perfume, right? That's too strong. You just step in the elevator. It's like Jesus. Oh my goodness, you're a woman and I'm a man. We're going to have to do something about that.
Ugh. Maybe it's just like because he's so sweaty and bug-eyed for the majority of this scene.
He is very bug-eyed.
I'm just like...
Do you think he's handsome?
In a vacuum, yes. It's just that like they keep making him all sweaty and look right. Weird. Yeah, no, as a human being, yeah, he's attractive. I wouldn't throw him out of bed, but like...
But now he's shaking and like, I'm sweating.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
But I at the same time, I think that's part of his persona and why he played certain characters had that weird, bizarre, like attractive quality. Where it's not quite like a bad boy situation, but it's like he's clearly like bizarre, you know? He's also very bizarre in another Hammer movie where, oh my God, what's the name of it? It's not Maniac. What's it called? Is it Paranoiac? Oh, I can't remember. I'll have to add that into the corrections for the show notes. But there's another really neat sort of like, it almost seems like a proto slasher movie where there's a killer who wears a mask and everything, but he's in that too. And that's also got some weird familial relationships.
Oh, she has to die because she was trying to tempt the pure good boy.
Yeah. And we see a lot of blood right there. More so than we've seen in the other two Hammer movies so far.
By far, actually, yeah.
That's another interesting thing to talk about with these Hammer movies, and really all the Hammer movies in terms of like the censorship and the scandal about like the bloodshed and everything going on at the time. I think also part of the reason why this one made less money is because it had the great misfortune of coming out in 1961 and being made quaint, so profoundly quaint, by movies like Peeping Tom and Psycho, where it's like, you know, the moment that happens, I think Hammer will still have an edge for the next like 10 years where they make a shitload of movies. But it's like their period of horror where it was really, really big, I feel, seemed to have been from the mid to late 50s. And then once Peeping Tom and Psycho happen, things start to shift a little bit. And then you get the 60s and it's like, well, now it looks like a lot of these, that's when you see a lot of these big Italian filmmakers who make the horror movies start to come into prominence, right? So now they have some competition for similar type movies. All those Italian ones are a little bit more like lurid and bloody too. So they're kind of different. So I don't know, they had more competition.
Well, yeah, than they did. I said this when I was watching it, but like this is one of the more hokey Hammer films. And I think that just is because, I mean, yeah, it's a product of its time, but also it didn't adapt to changing times at all, and it just sort of doubled down on we're like going to do a gothic era monster story, and if that doesn't translate well in the direction we're taking it, oh well, I guess we'll go out of business soon.
Yeah, I mean, they really tried to, and it's unfortunate because they created these really interesting movies at that time, and then the window closed and they just couldn't keep up with the creativity to keep doing anything. So then it turned into just stupid exploitation, really. You know, I mean, people can like those later Hammer movies, but you can't deny that a lot of them have this feeling of like trying to keep up with everything. So instead of making like actual, it's like a Warner Brothers thing the last 10 years with their superhero movies. Obviously has a lot more dire consequences for Warner Brothers because those movies cost $500 million each, right? And Hammer at the very least could continue to afford to make multiple movies, tons of movies, you know, all the time, just cranking them out for like the next 10 years, at least after this movie. And then things really start to slow down in the 70s. But, you know, it's the idea of not making creative decisions anymore to be ahead of the curve. You're just trying to keep up with it. And then I think that it becomes harder to be creative in that situation.
Even if you did bend those metal bars, how did he fit through that crack? Because the movie's implying that's how he got in.
Oh, I don't know.
Whatever. It was visually conveyed.
They don't explain it too much, but in this movie, when you're a werewolf, you also turn into rubber.
Yeah. Still looks better than the monster in Horror Express.
Leave Horror Express alone.
You don't remember when you said that you had a series of dreams about how much you loved the taste of blood and killing small animals?
But that doesn't mean he's actually a werewolf. You know, Max, I gotta admit, if I had that dream, I would not assume I'm a werewolf.
Would you assume your sister is a werewolf?
I mean, I already know that's true, so. The movie told me. It's not like it would lie to me.
No, it's the prostitute that you killed.
Again, the whole dream thing relating very much to that Freud case. It makes me wonder if part of our conception of werewolves for a lot of the 20th century owes a lot of debt to that famous case study that Freud did about the quote-unquote wolf man. You know, and in that dream, it's not like he turns into a werewolf, but wolves are a big part of it.
Yeah.
And then sheep. He relates it to like stories about like, oh, his granddad killing sheep or whatever. Which makes me wonder if that has to do with the Silence of the Lambs too. Like, it's just a very big case file. And since Freud, I think, has far more influence in the creative arts than in actual clinical psychology, you could probably draw a line between some of those things. But another interesting comparison between the Gorgon and this movie is that actually werewolves and Gorgons are very old monsters that both go back to ancient Greece at the very least. I think the very first story that's really like about, not about, but features like transformation into a wolf specifically is actually Gilgamesh. So that goes all the fucking way back. And werewolves obviously are not as prominent as Medusa. But I think there's a lot of interesting things that you sort of pull out of older types of werewolves. So I was doing research on that actually, and I uncovered some interesting things that make me wonder if Terrence Fisher's sensibilities are sort of influenced by this because it relates to the Gorgon and specifically like Terrence Fisher's worldview, it seems, on society, where one of my instincts was to just revisit the Satyricon and Petronius, because I remembered there being a werewolf from that old book. And sort of learning more about that again. And then also that sent me down a little bit of an internet rabbit hole where I started revisiting other old werewolf things. And then I eventually wound up at the Republic, right? By Plato. And he actually has Socrates in that book make an allusion to sort of werewolf stuff that's very interesting and I think plays into Terrence Fisher's worldview in this movie, where he's talking about that book is all about like debating government or whatever, right? You know, that's what like political science majors, I'm sure they read that and feel fucking good about themselves as undergrads. But anyway, so this passage, he's talking about what turns people into tyrants. And then he uses the werewolf as a description and references this king Lycaon, right? Which is where that word comes from, who there's a lot of different versions of this myth, but was turned into a wolf by Zeus. And in different versions, it involves human sacrifice as one, but then also trying to, you know, being very impious and trying to test the omniscience of Zeus, and then Zeus getting fucking annoyed. But an interesting thing about that is that Plato adapts it for those political things that I think relates to, like, very directly to the way the curse exists in this, where it's like it is through the terrible leadership that, you know, he makes that comparison. And it has to do with desire in that passage as well. He's like, okay, so once somebody has a taste for blood, so to speak, once somebody is used to treating other people like objects for their own gain, they're not going to stop. Right?
Yeah.
And then they become a quote unquote werewolf who consumes other people.
I guess, yeah.
And it's interesting because that's sort of the same thing. You're talking about excessive desire and extravagant appetites. But yeah, I just talked. Were you going to say something? I think I just talked over something.
No, I was going to comment of just like, this movie's a disaster at this point for me.
Why?
Like, we had, like, it's just structurally, like, you want to be picking up the pace now, not like trying to slow it down again and then picking it back up. It's just like a bunch of stops and starts almost.
The thing is, it's that it's trying to be like the other Hammer movies, but also has this innovation of the structure, right?
Yeah, well, like, that would work. This, like, stop and start structure would work if you cut out the entire backstory, or at least put it later in the movie, I would say.
But if you cut out the backstory, then it's not stop and start. I think that structure is an interesting part of it. It's just you can't also play the second half of the movie like a normal Hammer movie. You have to do it all the way. And you have to be committed to doing character things that you wouldn't necessarily do in the other Hammer movie. It's not like this movie is really loyal to the source material of the book. So fuck it, just do it anyway. Like, you know what would be interesting? Like, we're getting exposition that we've gotten 3 times now or whatever, right? Where he's like, he's not really explaining it to her, but he's like, did anything happen? And she's like, no. But we already know from the priest way earlier that he said, if the woman loves him genuinely, then it'll be fine. And it's like, okay, that's true, we know that. But then we spend an extra just 2 minutes waiting for it to be like, go away with me, right?
You have to say it. That was a flag for me.
Yeah. So again, very fragile.
Where I'm like, I know you're masculinity. I know you're going through a lot right now, buddy, but like,
oh, it's the police.
It's the popo.
Also, which is interesting, is both the Leon character and the Barbara Shelley character get that moment where they beg their lovers to go away with them. Right? Except in the Gorgon, our stupid idiot protagonist has no idea what's good for him and decides to stay around for no reason. Whereas this, you know, the woman actually agrees. And that's part of what's interesting. I think her character is actually quite different from some of the other Hammer women characters, because she is, again, going to defy her father very shortly out of love. And then she actually agrees to go away with him. This is something she wants. And she actually approaches him the first time. Right?
Yeah.
She has a little bit more agency and desire than what we might be used to seeing in this movie. And I feel like, it, you know, a solution potentially to the repetition or the just like, I don't know, just the repetitiveness of the second half of this movie, them sort of having to go through the motions of like explaining what it is again, even though we know already, is that if you make it more from her perspective, then the movie is more about her finding out. But the movie isn't going to do that, right?
No.
But that would also be interesting, right? Where she's the upper class woman who meets this random guy, but then they have this affair and then they want to leave. But then she goes on a mission to figure it out. That would be shaking it up, right? That would be committing to the real shift in perspective. But it's still trying to be like the other Hammer movies where it's just doing something a little bit more straightforward. But that's a pretty sick outfit though, I gotta say.
It's punk for that time. Very black. Yeah, for going away in your wedding, you're wearing a funeral outfit.
Oh, it's dad.
Dun, dun, dun.
Gonna interfere in the Oedipal process or whatever.
You were, weren't you? Oh, well, I say.
But I mean, that's a really good moment of defiance, right? Maybe there's a low bar set there. Definitely there is. But it's like none of the characters in this movie are especially fleshed out, but it's interesting to actually have her get more character moments, I think, than the lead character. The only thing we really see from him is him freaking out about like just knowing that he's a werewolf, right? But independent of his being a werewolf, how much do we actually know about him? We know that he's attracted to this woman. Okay.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Literally nothing else.
Right. Whereas we learn a lot more about her in this situation because of, you know, so much more is on the line for her in making this decision. There are real consequences for her when she says, yes, I was going to run away from him. Right. And that,
I love how the driver's just like, yeah, sure, whatever.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter who you're driving for.
Whatever. No, even though he could probably hear, like, the father and guy yelling, just like, no. Don't worry about that shaking door. Just take me to the center of town.
I guess the other really interesting thing to mention about the structure of this movie that I didn't bring up yet is how not only does it sort of put it in the realm of like that Victorian novel, George Eliot, Thomas Hardy, Charles Dickens, but also like it sort of pushes it toward the realm of like melodrama again, where by melodrama, that's another term that's kind of like difficult to use because it's both like an adjective to mean something that's like overly contrived and emotional, which is why it was usually applied to like what people would call women's films from the 1950s, things with Rock Hudson in them,
yes.
For example, Douglas Sirk movies. But it's also something that is like the basis of like a lot of, it's the basis fundamentally of like basically drama is contrivance. You can't have one without the other. So I don't know, but there's melodramatic and then there's melodrama as like a genre. And I think their approach to this story pushes it toward melodrama because it becomes a lot less about that dramatic question of whether he is or is not a werewolf or about a body count and becomes more about the thing that the priest sets up at the beginning where he's like, as long as he's loved, it'll be okay. Right? So the main focus of the movie is can he or can he not achieve that state where he is, you know, loved enough to actually be able to prevent from turning into the werewolf. You know what I mean? It's not so much about the werewolf itself. It's just that's the terrible consequence that comes from not achieving the more like melodrama type goal.
Oh, we just missed Salvador Dali playing the mayor for a second.
No, he's here again. There he goes.
You look like a werewolf. Was he sleeping in the same bed as that guy?
Of course.
He's not a werewolf.
He just opens his teeth and he has like
vampire fangs.
Yeah, plastic ones. That's not funny. Take those out now.
The dude's asking to be lit on fire. Like, you think they would just be like, yeah, sure. we have a backlog.
No, that'd be such a pain in the ass.
No,
it's like, oh God, like, we got to build a bonfire now. There's just no reason for it.
We have to get permits.
It's like, dude, I was literally about to just do fucking whatever they do when not burning people.
Exactly.
But it's very important. It's very important, Max. Again, the change in the melodrama goal, right? It's not a horror movie goal, so to speak. It's a terrible way to articulate it, but it's like, my point here is that the most important thing about this is like whether or not he will achieve love and society standing in between that and not the werewolf part of it, which is interesting. Oh, this moment is perfect. What did you think about this? I mean, you have to think that this is pretty good. They learn, the mayor learns they're engaged.
Yeah.
And then he asks, for people who are not watching, he asks our romantic lead, our female lead, do you know about his affliction? Do you know what's wrong with him? And then she says, no. She's like, he's totally normal young man.
Yeah.
And then he's like, so there's nothing wrong with this man. So I can leave him in jail. It's the tragic miscommunication, right? That's very like Victorian novel.
Why are they? Touch. I thought that the woman could. Okay, whatever.
What? And then the silver bullet comes back after all these years.
Why didn't you leave the woman? I thought that her presence calmed him down. Why didn't...
Because they had to go to the mayor to try to convince him to let that happen. And then when she says, no, he's a normal young man, not a werewolf, he's like, you guys are just being fucking assholes trying to get this murderer out of jail. Right? So he's like, take her away. She's not allowed to stay there.
I didn't fuck a werewolf. I'm not a furry, you piece of shit.
Well, interesting that you make that joke, though. Do you think that they've had sex?
I was implied to think yes, based on just two things of, like, the way they were passionately embracing when, like,
sure,
she snuck out, and also just sort of the expected fiancé's reaction when they find out that it's just like, oh, I love him and I want to marry him. It was just sort of like, oh,
sure,
now she's damaged property. How dare you?
Yeah.
But like, oh, I do love, I did remember liking this shot.
That lighting. It's pretty great.
The blues and oranges blend well together.
But yeah, I wonder if people might argue whether or not they had sex, because I think it does not fit necessarily with the moralistic worldview that these movies have.
Well, I think it still could. It's like they're engaged to be married, and like they both love each other. And then when he's being tempted by other women, he like feels sick and repulsed by it.
But again, part of the reason he goes is because of the lack he feels for her too, right? And he sort of just capitulates to his friend.
Yeah.
But part of the other reason I asked that is because even though she does express her own desire and a type of agency in standing up to her father, I wonder if, you know, just sort of...
This is like one of those like watching like something decay over time, sped up motion videos.
I mean, that's literally what it is.
I mean, I know it's
fading.
Up,
yeah.
But like,
I don't think the werewolf transformation in this one is really that great, but no. I do like the final look of it.
Well, final look is fine, but like, no. And yet again, every movie is on a grading curve with the transformation from American Werewolf in London, and none of them will ever surpass it, but some of them can take some good elements from it. This one, unfortunately, just kind of tapes patches of hair to him until he's a full werewolf.
Yeah, I mean, really, that's part of the only way people could do it for a long time. But yeah, there's two approaches, right? You have to think about it in two ways. You have to think about it both in terms of how good what you're showing looks technically, but also just conceptually. Like, I remember as a kid thinking that...
Oh, no, he's a Romulan.
That's a great close-up, though. It does look like a Star Trek thing, because it's just, like, slapped up, like, spirit gum on his face to make his eyebrows look a little bit big. But I think it's a nice close-up. But I think... Again, you have those two ways you have to think about it. And even though the movie is not good, I remember as a kid thinking that Van Helsing movie actually kind of had an interesting like conceptual take on it that I'm sure looks awful now because of the CGI.
Yeah.
But they're sort of, they act kind of like possessed. It's like the first kill from Nightmare on Elm Street with the girl floating on the ceiling. Like they climb up walls somehow, but also it's like they're ripping their own skin off.
Ugh.
One patch at a time, and then the hair comes in. Also, weirdly, in that movie,
her.
Ooh, I love that.
It is an update of like the classic, Universal Wolfman thing.
I don't know if Oliver Reed was actually the one in the suit.
I can't imagine. With,
I mean, I don't know.
Well, just like you're talking about,
they put Christopher Lee in the suit.
I know, but you're talking about how much of a pain in the ass he was to work with.
But this was literally his first starring role.
True.
Yeah. So I don't know. But I do think, whether it's him or someone else, they look very like athletic to me when they're running around. Like they look kind of like big, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I just think the way that, you know, they move really helps sell the transformation when you finally see it now for the first time. I forget what I was talking about. Van Helsing ripping the skin off. Yeah.
What did she think the silver bullet was for? It was a good luck charm to help him get out of jail?
I mean, I don't know. It depends on whether or not you're ready to accept that somebody is a werewolf. If you're not quite ready to get to that point yet, you're just going to assume it's literally anything else. Which is part of why I often say I would frequently die first in horror movies, because I will never assume it's a ghost, because I know ghosts are not real. It will never be a vampire, Max. It will never be a werewolf. Ooh, he's got great like close-ups and like reaction shots.
He does. Also, yeah. I love how the town is already organized into pitchfork torch wielding.
Yes. They have a special like horn that somebody blows into. Just lets everyone know.
It's just an app. It's Rioter without the E, just an R.
Or Riot with a Y.
Yeah.
We need a pitchfork emoji. That would be so useful.
Well, they're adding more and more specific ones. They just added the pinching finger one.
What?
Like
just like a little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I believe somebody's reaction on Twitter was just like, as somebody with a gigantic penis, this emoji doesn't scare me at all. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
That's probably would have been Oliver Reed's reaction. I mean, apparently, I learned a lot about his dick, guys. But, like, apparently he had a massive penis. But then one of the famous stories of him whipping it out to show the tattoos was, like, I don't know what was going on. I just remember reading the phrase that he got upstaged. And I'm like, what the fuck does that mean? Did someone else whip their dick out first? And then he, like, felt insecure.
And it had room for several eagles on it.
There's a whole nest.
You got a one eagle dick there, bitch.
One of them was Sam the Eagle.
Yeah, he just had like enough room on your dick for all a bunch of variations of eagles, different stylistic thing in it.
All different raptors. Yeah. I'm a raptor enthusiast.
Blends in perfectly.
He's like the lead from The Bird with the Crystal Plumage who loves all the birds.
Yeah.
This is part of that movie that you don't see.
Why are we watching The Bird with the Crystal Plumage instead?
Because we're doing Hammer.
I know.
And Dario Argento never had the good sense to make, well, there's vaguely werewolf-esque hands in Suspiria.
Yeah. Well, that's more just like a what the hell's going on moment.
Yeah. Super underrated moment from that movie, by the way, is how during the first kill, those hands very like delicately and gingerly pick up the cable to wrap around her head. It just like cuts to it like it's a joke. It's like, whoop. I imagine like a wealthy person like sticking their pinky out and like picking up a doily to put on a table to put tea on it.
I would say it's a joke.
The same way.
But as we've discussed before in the Spectator Film Podcast, Dario Argento had one joke in The Bird with the Crystal Plumage and it did not land, so he never tried jokes again in his movies.
Yeah, I don't think he knows what jokes are.
The artist who eats cats. It's
the best. Hilarious.
That's why he took all the humor out of his Dawn of the Dead cut. It's like, what are jokes? No. Horror movies are for blood and good lighting.
Why do all your accents come out as Russian?
I don't know. Maybe I'm secretly Russian somewhere.
Not even Russians. Russians would be like,
fuck you.
Yeah.
No, it's because I'm a mishmash of every fucking European and Eastern European country.
Oh, man. Here we go. That great synthesis of the public and private, right? Where you get the contrast of
the problem is we don't know anything about the public.
Yeah.
Like we've seen them in the bar, but like that's more of just an introduction to other characters.
Right.
And like
it doesn't have enough time to really explore it as much as you want for either the principal characters or the town.
Yeah. Like the town is rioting, but we've only seen this movie through the perspective of the elites the entire time. Like we haven't really seen like the town's effect of him being a werewolf.
And it feels like there are maybe not enough things to carry over like the town's response to him, where I think just naturally you want there to be more continuity between there being like the things that created the curse and made him a victim. Oh, this is the image I was talking about, by the way, where it looks excellent with him in the with the blood in his mouth. But, you know, him being the victim of things that society created. Like, I think the stuff with the father works really well because the father rejects him after he goes to the brothel or whatever it is, right? But he looks like a mess, not because he was at the brothel. He looks like a mess for the same reasons that, like, the father rejects him later. He looks like a mess because of the curse, which was he inherited from shitty society aristocrats, and then these shittiest society aristocrats later deem him, like, unfit and illegitimate for the same reason. They have to
put him down.
Yeah.
It's so sad, but I'm sorry, old yeller, you got rabies.
And then, of course, we have this very interesting moment. That was a great blood spurt, by the way.
It is.
Yeah.
Especially for Hammer.
And then, you know, the father reluctantly destroying the son.
And he's going to be crying over the body. Oh, let's drop all our torches on the ground and light the town on fire.
But yeah, I do think it would be better if there was some more continuity between, like, the fact that the entire town is somehow repressing this element or participating in it.
Or, like,
because that just makes it more tragic.
What if, like, you had, like, a different part? Because I'm saying, like, you could do the origin and flashbacks, but, like, you showed Leon interacting with the town, show that, like, the town likes him, and then, like, have it be so, like, the entire town is sort of in on it, but, like, they sort of accept it because they love him as a kid.
Sure. Or, like, you just need more relationship with the town and him, too. Because, again, outside of him being a werewolf, do we know a lot about him? No, not really. We know way more about his love interest just by the fact that she loves him.
Surprisingly, yeah.
Oh, by the way, that one point I wanted to mention earlier is, you know, maybe the reason she's allowed to express her desires because it's expressed in that very specifically, like, circumscribed way.
Yeah.
So maybe that's a possibility too. But again, it still tells you a lot more about her than him. We don't know what he wants to do.
Except get shot with a silver bullet.
Yeah. And then, you know, he winds up kind of being, I mean, it is successfully tragic, I think, with the dad killing him, but I don't know. It feels like it needs just a little bit more. But I think it still remains a very interesting, different Hammer movie for a lot of the reasons we discussed. So, yeah, do you have anything else to really say about this movie?
If you're looking for a Halloween-appropriate werewolf movie, I can't really recommend this as, like, something you'd put on just to get in a spooky mood, or, like, it doesn't have enough werewolf stuff to be a good put on the back of party movie.
Yeah, it's more melodrama.
Yeah, I think if you are a fan of Hammer and you want to see different ways they branched out and tried to cover different monsters and do a slightly different structure than their different other movies, it's worth a watch, but it's not one of my favorites by any stretch of the imagination. I think, like I said, I think it has some decent acting, some great costume design, great set design, some great practical effects for the werewolf stuff. Like you said, the shots of that toward the end stand out as some of the more interesting things in the movie. But it's just okay. It's not great. And go watch a different werewolf or Hammer movie,
yeah,
in my opinion.
I think I agree with you. I appreciate a lot about this movie, although I think that's different from necessarily just enjoying it, especially in a Halloween setting. It's like, put on fucking Dracula. I mean, Jesus, that Dracula movie is like perfect Halloween. The Gorgon is much better for Halloween. There are a number of different movies aside from this one that would be a lot better. Cause this one is a lot of people just running around and then an uncomfortable rape scene in the middle. So it's like, I don't know, but
that's a thing. You don't want rape in your spooky Halloween party movie.
Absolutely not. put on Horror Express. Then you can just, instead of rape, you just get Peter Cushing.
And put on Horror Express.
Missing
then,
out on
and then play sex. Rasputin by Boney M. over the entire movie.
Or just every scene where that monk is in it.
Rasputin.
But yeah, so, you know, I think I agree with a lot of what you're saying, but I'm glad we did it. I'm glad we did an interesting movie.
It's worth a watch.
Yeah.
Just, if you're listening to this to be like, oh, this is going to be the perfect movie to put on at my Halloween jamboree. No, it's not.
No.
Go find something else.
Yeah. So yes, this has been the Spectator Film Podcast. You can find us on spectatorfilmpodcast.com or on Spotify, iTunes, or Stitcher. We also have a Letterboxd account. And yeah, and then you can find Max if you look hard enough. So is this over? Is this the end of the show? Do you have anything else to say?
Your sister is a werewolf.